Star Trek, the next generation. You love throughout the nation. You're my favorite show. Was in every episode you're lucky. You don't have to wait for buses. You just step into the transporter and off you boldly go. Mr. Wolf's my favorite person.
We are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
Hello, friends, and welcome to bOrgCast 1.7. Oh, yes, travelling back in time. Way back to the first season of Star Trek The Next Generation, and that means beardless Riker, which means...
I'm back, baby!
And did no you miss me? She has regenerated into Andy.
You know what's really strange, though? When Andy regenerates into me, she has a beard.
Yeah.
It's kind of like an anti-Riker here.
Yeah.
Well, anti-season one Riker, anyway.
Let's face it, considering how much Amory likes beards, if she was able to regenerate into a man, she would choose the beard.
Oh, there you go, then, you see. So I'm glad we've cleared all that up.
Indeed.
There's some strange emotions going on in a minute. we'll gloss over those and sally forth with to season one of... Next year. Why did I agree to do this again?
Yeah, it's funny actually that when we were talking about this in the last bOrgCast, and Amory said, "Oh, I could send some feedback," and I said, "Yes, you'd have to watch the episodes, though." Funny enough, we have no feedback. Draw
really?
Your own conclusions.
That's a shocker, though, isn't it?
We do have feedback actually, but not from Amory.
No,
there have been some brave souls who've gone here.
Have they boldly gone?
Well, yes, or foolishly, possibly. But we are. But we also have some news. Star Trek news. I still can't get used to having new Star Trek
news. Star Trek news? Next thing you'll be telling me, it's Star Trek news about characters from the next generation.
Yes, because we're not the only ones travelling back in time, because we've got the Picard series, which was all over the internet the past couple of weeks. Oh, yes, no escaping it. We had those leaked pictures from sets, including the new uniform.
Oh, yes. What do we think of the new uniforms?
We think they look very Deep Space Nine, which is not a bad thing at all.
It's not.
A shirty thing, but other than that... Yeah,
high collars, it would appear that the rank pins on the front. A lot like the Season 1 Next Gen uniforms, I take note of.
You mean like the parallel universe ones?
No. So the rank pins in Season 1 Next Gen are on the front of the uniform, or more on the front than the collar.
Oh, yes, because there's no collar.
Yes.
Yeah, but they look okay. They're quite reasonable.
From what little we've seen of them.
Exactly. But definitely not a massive revolution there. Not necessarily a bad thing. Compared to, you know, how different the Discovery ones look to anything else. Except possibly Enterprise, I suppose. Yes, so we also have the news that it's going to be airing on Amazon. And you could hear the collective scream from those who don't have Amazon. Particularly those who are paying good money for Netflix to see Discovery. And are now going to have to, if they want to, watch the new series, fork out for Amazon as well.
Only outside of the US, though, because in the US, you're still going to get it on your CBS All Access, which you have to pay for as well.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I think we've got a slightly better deal in as much as an awful lot of other things to watch on Netflix and Amazon. I've no idea what CBS All Access actually gives you beyond Star Trek, but there we are.
I think the Twilight Zone?
Oh, wow. Yeah, I get chills. Or not. and, of course, then the trailer hits to... It was the anniversary of All Good Things. Which was a clever bit of thinking, that. Yes.
I'm 90% sure that was a happy accident. It wasn't planned.
I don't know, but on the basis we had an awful lot of vineyard scenes...
It was... I've heard it being compared to an advert for a spa, an advert for a winery, and an advert for Viagra.
Yeah, you take your pick. Some clever wag on, I think it was on Twitter, pointed out that the particular way the vines have been grown is completely different to the way they do it in All Good Things. It's like, oh, really? Oh, really? We've got vine geeks getting involved in this now.
Well, next thing you'll be pointing out is the fact he hasn't got a beard. God.
Yeah. Obviously shaved that morning, bless him. But beyond that, it's not giving a great deal away, as you wouldn't expect from a spoilery type thing. So yes,
A much better received teaser trailer than the Discovery one, I dare say.
Yeah, because they haven't shown a spaceship, have they?
They haven't shown a spaceship funny. Which looks like it was rendered mid-1998.
Yeah, oh, gosh. You take that to that, blimey.
Do you think we'll have spaceships?
It wouldn't feel like Star Trek if it didn't have spaceships, let's face it. It would be a brave move to set the entire thing in a vineyard for the entire series.
Well, a better question, Ed. Do you think we'll see an Enterprise?
I'm sure we will at some point. Because
but which one? Wouldn't.
Well, it ain't going to be, I suppose it could potentially be the E, but it would be quite old by then, wouldn't it? So we're looking at the F, which isn't, that's not something we've seen.
You're saying that, though, the E would only be as old as the original was at the time of the movies.
You mean the redone constitution?
Yes, the refit.
Yeah, possibly. I won't have a problem with the E. I mean, I don't think we really saw enough of the E.
I'd quite like to see the E, just to see maybe a slightly upgraded E. No third nacelle, though. I'm good without the third nacelle.
I don't think any ship needs that, really.
No.
We shall see. It's, as I say, not giving too much away, but that's what you expect at this stage. Keep us salivating. And yes, if I was a big fan of wine, I guess I'd be doubling up. I mean, if he was brewing his own beer at this point, I really would be excited, but...
Maybe it's not so much for... I don't think Picard's a beer man. Who do we think? Worf is doing blood wine, so it's not going to be him. Riker, perhaps? No.
No,
it's
no.
Geordi. Geordi's the beer person.
Possibly, yes.
I can see Worf doing a stout. Is that a euphemism? Klingon stout. So will the broadcast be covering Picard? Or does that remain to be seen?
Well, on the basis we took a dive and we did Discovery, I can't see us not doing Picard, with the same caveat that we had for Discovery, which was if we turn out hating it, then we won't carry on, because there's nothing worse than just hearing somebody bitching about something. So, but I can't see how this won't be good, really, at least good. I mean, it might not be amazing, but it's got to be at least good, because A, Patrick Stewart can still act. Mm-hmm. And B, we're just so excited to see this era of Trek, the future of Trek, effectively.
Yes, it's been a while since we've been back in the future.
Exactly. So really, they're going to have to try quite hard, I think, tempting fate, to shoot themselves in the foot with this. But we shall see.
Yes.
Excellent. Well, that's the future. Let's go back to the past. Oh, yeah. Oh, no. As we cover the episode 11001001, which is such a catchy title. If you're a computer,
it is
11001100011100011100002.
Next time on Star Trek: The Next Generation, the crew docks at a starbase for repairs.
I'm getting an indication of possible trouble in main engineering.
But kidnappers trick the crew into an emergency evacuation.
Abandon ship!
Stealing the Enterprise and its captain.
This vessel must not fall into hostile hands.
Set auto-destruct sequence. Now.
It's a deadly countdown to disaster on Star Trek: The Next Generation.
So we have a beautiful opening shot that established that the Enterprise has been called to Starbase 74 in orbit around Tarsus 3. And of course, it's the fantastic space station model from Star Trek 3.
Does look suspiciously like Space Dock, doesn't it?
Yes.
Clearly, it must be much larger to facilitate the entry of a Galaxy-class starship.
Yes, that is a bit of an issue, isn't it? Because when the old Constitution came out, it pretty much filled the door. Mm. And funny enough, so does the Galaxy-class, which is much bigger. So, yes, this is clearly a scaled up. They wouldn't do such a thing, would they?
I feel being given both somewhat starship pedants, would you say?
Yeah.
I do have to point out that while the Constitution class barely fit through the doors in Star Trek 3, the significantly larger Excelsior also managed to fit out through those doors. So,
yeah. So that's potentially a problem just with Star Trek 3, full stop. But there we go. It's far more dramatic, isn't it, if they only just fit out? I think that's probably the issue. Mm. Also, in this case, it's not orbiting the Earth, of course.
Nope.
So they've altered the planet to make it look a bit more alien.
And it looks really good on the remaster on the Netflix.
Yes, fantastic. So I must admit, I watched the DVD for this just because I was taking the usual screenshots for Tumblr. So I've got old school. So I really ought to, because I've got them on Blu-ray, I really ought to dig those out as well. Except I really can't face watching this episode again anytime soon. So
Interesting. Yeah. Ooh.
Because this is as good as it gets. I mean, always what I remember about this episode, and that's why I always get excited about it initially. And then you remember, actually, yes, it's just all about Riker wanking off in the bloody holodeck, isn't it?
Yeah, I did make a note, but this entire episode seems to be just Riker being a bit of a dick to everyone. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Riker is a wanker, basically. Mm-hmm. This is this episode. Anyway, this beautiful footage will be reused later in Remember Me, mm-hmm. Ensign Ro and Phantasms to represent other star bases, obviously. But hey ho, it's not like they're not going to reuse beautiful shots like this.
One last and interesting point I have to make.
Yeah.
The footage of the Enterprise entering space dock is mirrored, it's flipped.
Oh no!
So
I'm going to be looking for that next time.
The registry number's the wrong way around. You're welcome.
I definitely won't be revisiting this unless could they not have done something about that on the remaster, for heaven's sake?
Short of having the Enterprise enter from, like, if you flip the shot, but yeah, they could again without digitally painting over or re-rendering it. Then no.
yuck! Bugger. But at the time, this was very, very exciting because here we have, you know, movie level effects on a TV show. So this was what I was in for Star Trek Next Generation for. Mm-hmm. Just a pity that the rest of the episode really doesn't live up to it. But never mind.
It's a lovely Picard painting, isn't it?
Yes. Picard mentions they're getting a systems check, including the malfunctioning holodeck, a reference to the big goodbye. Although originally this story would have come before that, and the malfunctioning holodeck would have been as a result of the binar's alterations. But anyway, it works either way around, doesn't it?
I suppose so, yeah.
Love the fact that when the Enterprise enters, there's the spotlights reflecting off her hull, which is brilliant. That was obviously one of the passes they did to add that on.
Look, they clearly spent the entire budget for this episode on that entering the space dock.
Yeah.
Because the rest of it's a bottle show. It's just using the sets. And even then, they get rid of most of the extras. So every penny they had was for entering space dock.
Yeah, I mean, technically it isn't a bottle show because that would just be involving the ordinary cast. And we do have some guests here, but let's face it, they're pretty much wearing Hessian sacks, aren't they?
I was pretty sure that they just got Patrick Stewart wearing a fake beard and they did that thing where they split the screen.
Yeah, it's more of him later.
And now it's time for Who's at the...
Well, it's season one, so therefore it's... Geordie.
Ah, yes, there you go. So
which was the way it was originally, but we got so used to him actually being down in engineering later on that it seems weird seeing him behind the con. But there we are. That's how he started off. We see the docking connections and a worker bee.
Yes.
Nice. Ah, brilliant. I mean, considering how much more difficult producing these effects were back in the days, you've got to pat them on the back for the effort, haven't you?
Well, but because they spent the effort on it, is why it still looks so good today on the remaster, you know. Because, again, we both love Deep Space Nine. Some people, for reasons known only to themselves and their God, love Voyager. But the effects in those shows just don't stand up as well when we got into the CG stuff.
Yeah, and well, not until they started remastering some of Deep Space Nine for What You Leave Behind. But anyway, more of that some other date.
Yes.
And when may as well cover this now. It's coming out in, a couple of months' time? July, I think, is the version's going out to people who did the, what you call it, Patreon or whatever it was.
Yes, what backed it. I know that there's a screening on at the Prince Charles in the not-too-distant future.
Oh, yes, which is sold out.
Yes, they've brought on a second, there's a second screening going on now.
Yes, but we shall be going to the first one. I do hope you are, sir.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Wouldn't miss it, sir. Wouldn't miss it.
That's going to be well freaky seeing me and Emery up on the big screen. I tell you, this is going to be my 30 seconds of fame. I'm going to make the most of it. Anyways, that was slightly off track there. Let's get us back focusing on the exciting stuff. We meet Commander Orphil Quinteros.
I thought it was Quinteson. I was just caught because Emery likes to give people funny names. So he was Commander Quinteson for me.
See, I'd gone to a Quintana place with the Big Lebowski.
Okay, well.
Yeah. And Orphil, not that they mention his first name on screen, but there's a reason for that, I suspect.
Yeah.
Orphil?
I wish I could fly way up to the sky, but I can't.
You can?
I can't. I wish I could see what folks see in me, but I can't.
Anyway, he's played by Gene Dynarski, who was the Randy Miner Ben Childress in season one's Mud's Women. Yeah, someone who could have done with the holodeck back then, I suspect. Instead, he had to put up with androids. He was also Leotard Sporting Council member Krodak in season three's Mark of Gideon. That's the one where they're completely overpopulated, which has got some brilliant visuals, but isn't such a great story, it has to be said. Well, it's in season three, what do you expect? Plus, he was also in 60s Batman, The Monkees. You know, I've not seen The Monkees in years.
Probably with good reason.
Yeah, I can't help feeling it really is. It's like the banana splits as well. That was like a staple summertime BBC. They'd be showing that sort of shite. And back then it seemed okay, but I'm sure it won't now. Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Never seen it, but he's Ike in that, apparently.
Yeah, we should probably fix that at some point.
Possibly. The A-Team. Yes, everybody's been in the A-Team, let's face it. And likewise, the X-Files. To name a few.
Are we 100% sure it's not actually Patrick Stewart with a beard?
He's similar, isn't he? A bit taller, though, I think, to be fair. So it's Patrick Stewart in a beard and with platforms, yes. Maybe. Yeah. Riker asks whether the people accompanying him, these gentlemen, are Bynars.
Yeah, could we just address Riker and his lack of pronoun etiquette here?
Yep.
It seems to be a recurring theme throughout this episode is that Riker is just being a massive dick.
Yep.
And despite being very clearly told straight away that, you know, the Bynars have no gender, consistently and repeatedly refers to them as male.
Yeah, it is very, very annoying. Yes. And you'd think that this sort of thing would be covered in Starfleet training. It wouldn't be a... You know, because you're going to learn about these different species, surely. But no, it takes him completely by surprise that there can be genderless beings in the 24th century.
What the really damning thing is, as I remember, isn't Riker and Troy in charge of HR on the Enterprise?
Pretty much, yes.
Okay, yeah. That would explain a lot. Also, I noticed anyway, that the Bynars were played by women as well.
Yes, and kind of, well, the voices modulate. They do come across very much like the Talosians in The Cage, which is quite cool. Anyway, Quinteros puts Riker right. Mm-hmm. Yay, well done. We're introduced to 1-0, who's played by Alexandra Johnson. Nothing particularly exciting about her. Certainly not her name. Because really, there aren't going to be very many variations in names, are there, for Bynars? The other one is called 0-1, and she's played by Katie Boyer, who was the union rep for the docking crew in Babylon 5 in the first season.
I remember that.
Yes. Mm. She also played a mum in Jurassic Park The Lost World, apparently. Not sure I've seen that one.
It's the one with the dinosaur running around San Diego.
Right. No, don't think I have seen that. And she was also a mum in Minority Report. And she was in The X-Files, of course.
Oh, excellent.
Anyway, it's going to get a bit confusing because there are a very limited number of names these folk can have. But never mind, just as well, we only meet four of them, really. The makeup design is good, though.
I quite like the makeup. It stands up very well on the... I'm going to keep talking about the high def, but I was impressed. I legitimately was like, oh, that's very good. I also noticed something interesting, that between this and with the Traveller, Starfleet does seem to be contracting a lot of non-Federation alien species to do their ship upgrades on their flagship.
This is true. They're making the most of these specialised beings who aren't actually members. Yeah, no, that's quite cool, really, yes.
Only in season one, because they stop after that.
Yeah, I think so. But they also, unfortunately, seem to contract loads of people that don't have any money to spend on clothing because their costumes are as cheap as chips, aren't they?
Yeah, this was, I think, still the age where they were just using what was left over from TOS.
Yeah, it looks a bit like that, yeah. Apparently their language is close to binary, hence being in pairs. And it's a good sound effect when they talk. Mm-hmm. That's all right. Bynars apparently get a mention in Enterprise.
They do, yes. I believe Phlox mentions them at one point.
Uh-huh. But otherwise, they're conspicuous by their absence in the rest of Trek.
They do feature quite heavily in the Starfleet Corps of Engineer novels, which I know you will be an avid reader of.
No. Funnily enough, no. Mm. Okay. Well, what a surprise. Picard says he's looking forward to turning on his personal relaxation light and reading.
Yes. So, okay.
Personal relaxation light.
What?
Funny enough, we don't hear about them ever again either.
No, we don't. I imagine it's some sort of red bulb.
Yes, that's it.
And I imagine it might have come out later in this episode, but we'll get to that.
Mm-hmm. Riker discovers there are now four Bynars who don't act at all suspiciously when challenged. We get 0-0, played by Ivor Lane, who was the catchily entitled female crew member in Star Trek The Motion Picture. Yeah, I don't think she even gets a speaking role in that.
Okay.
And 1-1 is the one, of course. Number one deputises Wesley in his rainbow jumper. Oh, season one. To keep an eye on them. Yeah. And that's our exciting teaser, which... Yeah, maybe they're obviously looking suspicious. Maybe it'd be worth watching, you think?
I have to say that I think it's entirely reasonable. The Enterprise showed up late and were told they have to get the job done quickly. And while we might perceive it as suspicious, it's just an alien culture we don't necessarily understand. I think everything they said was entirely reasonable. I think it was just Riker just being speciesist?
Possibly, yeah. Right, that's our teaser then. Riker bumps into Yar. Remember her? Blimey.
Ah, yeah, Yar. What could have been?
Yes. We've got Worf and two unnamed crew members who don't get to speak. They're all off to play Parisi Squares. Remember that? That was a thing in season one.
It was. It's Star Trek's version of Pyramid.
It is. Yes. Except we'd actually get to see them play, do we? In their sexy blue Lycra outfits. Riker tells them to win, and Worf says they will, whatever the cost. So that could get quite ugly, I suspect.
It's true. I do quite like, if winning is not important, why keep score?
Somebody's going to get a Worf to the face. The lights dim due to the systems upgrade taking place, which is a bit worrying, really. Data is doing art.
Is this the first instance of Data doing art?
I believe it is, yes, under his best boyfriend Geordi's guidance.
Yeah, although, again, Riker being a dick here.
Yes. Yes, if it had been the other two, I'd have told him to F off, but there you go.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's just, damn it, Riker. Look, just go to the holodeck. Piss off.
Yeah. Yeah. Dr. Crusher, because we get to see all the crew at this point, is excited about meeting a cyberneticist.
Oh, she says she's. That's the reason. No, no. That's a firsty doctor. She has got a gentleman. she's got a gentleman call and she's late for it.
And unless he's Irish and a ghost, she's not interested. McFadden's having fun bringing a bit of character to the Doctor. You could argue she's a bit OTT in the first season, but she seems to have a lot more character in the first season. Then she gets kicked off for a year. Yeah. She returns, she's a bit more sort of restrained, which is a shame, I think.
I quite like the, you know, just the exciting getting to the turbo lift and then having to grab the box of toys from Riker.
We would have got a scene with her meeting the cyberneticist. I'm just imagining a guy with big earphones and connecting jug handles and silver and saying delete a lot, but there you go. That's just the Doctor Who for me. But it was cut for time. Cut for time in a story that has way too much jazz trombone playing, let's face it. Yeah, but apparently that's the exciting bits. Commander goes to the holodeck, which 1-1 and 0-0 have been working on, and he calls up a jazz bar in New Orleans.
Hello, and welcome to Jazz Club, bringing you all that's best in the world of jazz. Nice.
He summons up his bone, oh my heavens, and a trio to play with, Fanar. The bassist is played by the late Abdul Salam El Razak. You recognise this guy?
No. I want a bit part in your life. The walk on would be fine. I just want a bit part in your life.
Okay, this is just like working with Amory.
I like to maintain some level of... It's like with a doctor, you know? Yeah. It's a new thing. But there's some things are consistent. The sonic screwdriver and me not recognising people.
Okay, well, I did recognise this guy just because we watched Terminator 2 a couple of weeks ago.
Well, I wasn't invited.
Yeah, I know, funny that. because you were still Amory at that point, you see.
Oh,
But again, continuity, Amory never remembers seeing anybody in anything. Anyway,
how do you know I'm not an earlier version and Amory regenerated out of me?
Okay. Timey-wimey, I don't want to go into that, really.
No,
it's not. We're definitely not exploring this relationship at all, because this takes us to scary places. Anyway, he was the guy who got knocked out and put in the toilet, the complex where Miles Dyson is working.
Oh, yes.
He's the security guy who says, I'm not letting you in unless you see the pass, which was a foolish thing to say. He asks for an audience. This is Riker, of course. And logically gets a crowd, but Riker is thinking, more intimate. Oh, yeah, because of course. But then we go for... Oh, this is terrible. Right, so he rejects a blonde because they don't mix with jazz, apparently. Because no blonde person has ever listened to jazz, obviously. Yeah. He gets an auburn-haired lady. Now that is truly exceptional. Yes.
Good. But then we get the most damning one of all.
Well, he asks for more sultry.
Yes.
He's like that guy that on... Which was that beat-em-up game where you could make the boobies bigger on the female characters. That's Will Riker, that is.
Yeah.
I mean, could he try a bit harder to objectify women, do you think?
The whole trope about what Riker does on the holodeck stays on the holodeck, the whole thing about, you know, not wanting to have to wash up the holodeck after Riker, I'm pretty sure comes solely from this episode.
Yeah, this is Genesis of the Semen Stain, definitely. Which wasn't a Doctor Who that went down very well.
It's not.
It's a family show, goddammit. Anyway, I must stop laughing because I've done my back in, and every time I laugh, it kills. Anyway, he wants more sultry, and we get a slow pan up the legs of his chosen holographic sex puppet for the evening. And suddenly I remember why Amory has bailed at this point, to be honest. This is, of course, Minuet, played by Caroline McCormick.
Yes.
Who will return as fake Minuet, or Min.
Min Riker.
Min, yeah, this takes me to a goon show place, in Season 4's Future Imperfect, which, yeah, yes, let on that, therefore, that Riker's been manipulated in that particular episode. She was also in Enemy Mine. You seen that?
No.
Oh, okay. It's basically Arena, but with a budget.
Okay.
Exactly the same plot, embarrassingly. Annoyingly, Riker keeps referring to the binars as gentlemen.
Yes.
Despite still being told they're genderless. Mm-hmm. They beat a hasty retreat, and who can blame them?
Well, they need to get out of a splash zone.
Exactly. Yeah. Picard asks Wesley where Riker is and gets directed to Holodeck 4, which could get very awkward.
Oh, I think it's definitely going to get awkward.
Yep. Not as awkward as it could have been, let's face it.
Well, don't we know? Yeah. I'm just saying, we cut away from that scene for quite a while, and we come back, there's definite pillow talk taking place.
Riker shows off his bone technique to Minuet with a rendition of The Nearness of You by Hoagy Carmichael and Ned Washington. Not that I recognise that, I did look that up.
I was about to ask, did you just do that by ear? Or
No, I am not a jazz fan, I think it's fair to say.
I mean, really? I would never have guessed.
Yeah, funny that. I mean, this isn't a bad tune, to be fair. And that is Frakes playing, so all credit to him for that. Just as well, because we hear quite a bit of it. He and Minuet dance and talk about nothing much for a very long time.
I get another cringy line from Riker here. How far can this relationship go?
Yeah.
Mike, dude, you're on duty for one thing, yeah. Riker, okay? Also, lock the door, because anyone could walk in on you, and look who did.
Yeah, funny that. At this point, there's just like zero peril or drama. Well, I suppose slight peril, because you don't want to be seeing Riker getting it on. But that's as far as peril goes. Mm. And it just gets turgid. He just rules over her, basically. I'm as real as you need me to be, the sex puppet says. Oh, my God.
Yeah, this is not...
And none of the writers at this point went, hang on, guys, isn't this getting a bit creepy? Am I just picking up a bit of a creepy vibe here? Apparently not, no.
Well, let's not forget... This is season one, which means they're mostly reusing phase two scripts. And two, as much as we love and respect the Great Bird of a Galaxy, Roddenberry still has an awe in on some of this stuff.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
Yeah.
And when we say all, we mean his penis. Anyway, enter the captain. Arguably not a moment too soon, although you're claiming that actually it's too late.
I'm telling you, there's pillow talk coming up.
She talks to him in French. And he manages two whole sentences before resorting back to Yorkshire. Because that's as far as they're willing to go at making Picard French. But hey, it's more boring dialogue as Picard reflects on the versatility of the programme. Yes, that's what you're enjoying there, is it, Picard? Splendid. Mm-hmm. Wesley calls Data and Geordi with a possible problem in engineering. And they decide they're not going to bother their superior officers with it, because why would you do that? Hey-ho.
We know what they should do. They should send a message down to the chief engineer. I'm sure that he and or she would be able to take care of it.
Yeah, depending on whose job it is this week.
It's true.
Anyway, when they do try and contact their superiors, they can't contact the captain or Riker.
No.
But that's apparently not suspicious at all.
No.
The antimatter containment field is about to collapse, so we get our first ship evacuation, with people leaving by foot and transporter, which is very sensible and definitely something I remember reading about in the technical manual. So, excellent geek points.
I have to ask a couple of questions here.
Yeah.
Question the first, where is everyone in engineering?
Yeah, funny that.
Question the second, surely if you have a problem with the antimatter magnetic containment field, more than 5 minutes notice to a warp core breach might be good.
One would hope, but apparently, I don't know, perhaps... Just let it get too serious before dealing with it. I don't know.
It's the whole, you know, the clock's got to get down to one before it'll stop, isn't it?
Yeah, basically. That's it. Let's face it, we need tension in this episode, goddammit.
Oh, and something else I noticed here.
Yes.
A male computer voice.
Yes, we haven't quite settled into Majel Barrett being the computer voice. We do hear her, is it, in this?
She's in it quite a bit. But there's three distinct computers that I could hear. There's the normal Majel Barrett one. There's another female one, which might be Majel Barrett doing a slightly different voice.
I don't think it is, if I remember rightly. No. And this is the first time I think we hear Majel Barrett as the computer voice as well.
But then there's also a male. So even within this, there's like three different computer voices. I know the Enterprise has three computer cores. Do they argue with each other?
Schizophrenic. Excellent. Oh, dear. Anyway, in order to protect the starbase and the planets that they're in orbit of, they initiate an automatic departure sequence, which I guess makes some sense. Mm-hmm. And well done, Starfleet, for designing that into spaceships.
Yeah.
When Geordi and Data beam off, they realise they've left Picard and Riker behind. Career-enhancing move there, guys.
I was going to say, in the Terran Empire, they'd be doing very well at this point.
Yeah. Welcome to the, what do they call them, the torture booths or whatever they are.
Agony booths.
Agony booths. Yes, they can see the containment problem has been reversed, but Quintaro says it's too late to beam back aboard, despite the fact the ship's not actually that far away at this point.
Well, it's not even out of a space dock at that point.
I mean, they can beam down from orbit of a planet, but apparently, no, they can't possibly beam halfway across a space station.
Apparently not. No.
Mm. Whoops.
Also, you'd think with a very advanced computer system like on the Enterprise, on automatic pilot, if the doors were closed, maybe it wouldn't try and go out.
Yes. Anyway, so we get lots of pictures of empty corridors, which is thrilling. And then we switch to the even less exciting scenes in the holodeck again.
Pillow talk. I'm telling you, this is pillow talk.
Riker confesses he could develop feelings with minuets. Well, I'm sure he already has feelings in his pants. Picard realizes that he's Captain Gooseberry and tries to leave. Yeah. But Minuet insists he can't, alerting them to their situation and discovering that they're headed for Binus. Yes. They tool up in the weapons room, which is nice, except you don't actually see the weapons room, just the label on the door, which is a bit disappointing. If it was one of the movies, you'd see racks and racks of phaser rifles, but no, they haven't even made one phaser rifle yet, let alone racks of them.
We're still using the Dustbuster phasers here, aren't we?
Yes, the earlier model as well, that really do look like Dustbusters. then they head for engineering to initiate auto-destruct, which they do without any 1A, 2B stuff.
Well, they've got fingerprint scanners. You don't need that if you've got a fingerprint scanner.
That's not proper Trek unless we get one. I'm sure we do later on in Next Generation as well.
Yeah, we do. We also get the option to vary the length of time you want for your auto-destruct.
Yeah, it's funny that, isn't it? Somebody's finally thought of that. Mm. Anyway, it's a really shonky-looking 80s display that times down to 5 minutes, isn't it? Digital countdown. It's like something from We Are the Champions, for heaven's sake.
I think that display was made by Casio.
Yeah, definitely. In the 70s. Data gets guilt over spending time painting rather than being on the bridge. Bless him. Considering the quality of his painting, he should really feel guilty. The Enterprise is the only ship around, as per usual, so they can't pursue. There's not a single shuttlecraft or anything they could possibly use.
Now, to be fair, we do get a couple of ships get name-checked here. We have the USS Trieste, who cares? But we also hear a name drop for the USS Melbourne.
Ah.
And do we know where we hear the Melbourne from later on?
Is it that the one that Data ends up on?
Nope. That's the one that Riker is often the command of just before Best of Both Worlds and is blown up.
Right.
See, I quite like that about season one of Next Gen, is that there was some kind of a continuity over the ships you saw, and they were all kind of in the same neighborhood.
Yeah,
they reused the names a little bit. You know, we kept seeing the Hood showing up, and you had the Melbourne, and I think the Wellington was mentioned at the beginning, which is also the one which Ensign Roe was on.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I just like that little name drops there. It might seem smaller than you get in Deep Space Nine when you have thousands and thousands of ships, but it also seems more continuous, like it's all connected a bit more.
The downside is they quite often don't end up with the same registry numbers when they appear the second time on screens and things. Admittedly, you have to sort of freeze frame to see it. But
I think in Next Gen it was okay with that.
I'm thinking specifically of, what was the Galaxy Class one, the Yamato.
Yes,
gets two different numbers, sadly.
Yes.
And I know how much you love that sort of thing.
Well, the worst one for me is the Hood, because the Hood, when you first see it, is NCC 2541. And then later on, it's like 4406152. And it's like, the fuck?
Yeah. It hit too many speed cameras and they changed the registry number.
Pretty much, yeah.
Beaming to the bridge, which is interesting in and of itself, Picard and Riker find the Binar slumped on the floor, pleading for help.
I like how they even collapse in unison, though. It's nice.
Yes. Logical. They cancel the auto-destruct, but now they're in orbit of Bynus. The planet's central computer is down, probably downloading a Windows update, so it could be down for ages.
Oh, yeah.
The humans realise that Minuet is the only clue to what's going on. Back to the holodeck! Diddly-dly. She reveals the Bynus computer has been knocked out by an electromagnetic pulse from one of their stars going nova, apparently. They should have thought about that, really, surely, but never mind. They've downloaded their computer into the Enterprise, but now they've got to get the information back again. Hailing Starbase 74 to ask Data where they can find the Bynars file. I mean, surely a file that big, an alien, would be easy to find, you'd think. But
well, I think it wasn't the file so much as it was the EXE file.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they were looking for.
Right. Data suggests it would be a binary file name. And unsurprisingly, it turns out to be 11001001. They should have just looked at the top of the script, really, shouldn't they?
Yeah, would have
never
saved
mind.
A bit of time.
Yeah. The access only works when both Riker and Picard access it, though, together, because the Bynars work in pairs.
Does seem to me like a bit of an oversight on the Bynars' part, because they were only planning to kidnap Riker, weren't they?
Yes. It's like, again, Picard was like a bonus, but then again, without two people, they're screwed. So maybe they had somebody else that were planning to trap a bit later on. But because they ended up with Picard, I don't know.
You know, I haven't seen Wesley in a while. Where is he?
Yeah. Bynars recover and thank the officers. Why didn't you ask for help, Picard says? You might have said no. They'd, I guess, logically answer. Because they're binary, yeah.
Who's at the...
It's Picard!
Yes, Picard's at the con.
Only one of three occasions that he takes the con. I mean, it's fairly logical here because there's only bloody two of them to do it.
Well, I seem to recall numerous references to Riker being the best pilot in all of Starfleet.
Except in Booby Trap, where specifically Picard declares that he has to do it because he's the best pilot.
Yeah.
Okay. And Conundrum, where isn't that the one where he's one of the very few people on the bridge anyway? So
that's the one where they can't remember who's who.
Yeah, that's right. So he thinks he might be the, despite the fact they've got pips on their bloody... Anyway, let's not... We've done that. Move on. Riker rushes away to finish off with Minuet. Yeah. Nice. But she's changed her face for some reason, hopefully to put him off.
She is faking it. She's just ghosting him. She's like, nah, I've got to get rid of him.
And Riker's left with blue balls, bless him. Basically, this is quite a good idea, but we really, really could have done without all the creepy Riker Minuet stuff. They'd just done something different than that. Then I could have bought this episode a lot more easily. But as it is, this is just a creepy, creepy episode of creepy with some shiny effects.
You see, I don't hate this episode. I don't like Riker. Or rather, mm-hmm. I like seeing how bad Riker is with the benefit of hindsight, because this is so unlike the character we get later on. This is like all his bad elements cranked up to 11.
Yes.
So it's interesting seeing like a proto-Riker. You know, Amory's fond of saying without the beard, he's not Riker. This is the caterpillar stage before he evolves into the butterfly.
The creepy caterpillar.
The creepy caterpillar that is Riker. But if you take that away, I like the whole arrival at the starbase. I'd forgotten, I quite like Season 1 of Next Gen in the way that the universe seems more real with the connections. I like how just seeing more people in the corridors, when you saw people in the corridors, a lot of it was empty here, but it just felt more populous. And we saw the Scant, which I think...
Yes.
Yay, we saw the Scant. Yes. Scant watch. So yeah, I compared to what's coming up in a minute, this was a delight.
If you compare the two episodes we're covering today, and believe me, the ones we'll be covering after this as well, even worse. So yes,
why did I agree to do this again?
Yeah, it's a sliding scale, and we're up very much on the downward at the moment. But never mind. Mm-hmm. But yeah, as I say, I mean the initial effects are nice, but from then on inwards, creep city. We have heard from Doreen. She says, while far from the best that Next Generation has to offer, at least the self-destruct countdown was silent. Yes, actually slightly disappointed about that as well. The premise that a binary species could only see things in black and white was interesting. And as soon as they started upgrading the Enterprise's computer, red flags were flying in my brain. Yes, you just knew from the get-go that this was not going to work out well, didn't you?
Yes. Was this before or after the Traveller episode, by the way?
This, I believe, is after the Traveller episode. That's quite early on in the season.
So they still haven't learned their lesson at this point.
Really haven't, have they? No, just let these strange beings tinker with their stuff. Doesn't work out well. Never mind. Thank you, Dory. And we've heard from Puri.
Hello, Orgs. Puri here to talk about 11001001. Catchy title to the episode. Now, this one, I actually didn't mind. You know, for season one, I didn't think this was that bad. I think the big issue is what the thing does well is. Well, actually, I was going to start with almost the Captain America, because it's you and Andy. So imagine me kind of climbing onto a chair and saying, so, you've had a long rant about how they just built a bigger space dock. I like to think there was a Klingon on the design team. So they were saying, how are we going to build a star base like space dock on Earth that's big enough to accommodate the new giant galaxy classes? And the Klingon went, just build it bigger. That's what we did with the Burrell class. And they kind of go, what, really, just... Yeah. See where that says like 100? Yeah, make it like 1500. And, you know, everyone just kind of looked at him and went, actually, he's got a point there. That's my theory of course, we're just reusing some Star Trek 3 shots. But on the, particularly on the cleaned up versions, it actually looks quite neat to see the Enterprise coming in. And, you know, seeing things like the docking tubes, the way people walking down it, I was impressed by that stuff. The episode itself, I quite liked everyone now going off for shore leave, and the idea that they delete some apps in order to make room for presumably Enterprise OS 15 or something. That seemed, well, then they were shutting things down. But Riker's just bored; he's just milling about the ship, trying to annoy everyone. But everyone's got stuff to do except him. You know, Picard's just going to sit and read a book. The half the crew are off to play Mornington Crescent or whatever Parisi Squares is, and Data and Geordi are painting. You know, and Riker's just bored, so he goes and plays some jazz. That's where I think it falls down. I've got to admit, the whole minuet line, while I see where they were going with it, I just don't think that bit works that well. I'm not a huge jazz fan, which definitely is part of it. So he's kind of sitting there playing his jazzy trombone, and apparently that makes the chicks go wild. Who would have thought it? I was one brass instrument off. I was French horn. No one fancies a French horn player. But the bits that I thought worked were actually things like the evacuation. It still doesn't quite work for me that they can evacuate. I mean, look at it this way. I work in a sizable office building at the moment. We can't evacuate an office building with it's only a few hundred, maybe 1,000 people in it. I don't know, I've never actually counted how many are on my floor, but it's a big building, and it can't evacuate in 5 minutes. When I worked in the training school, it could maybe evacuate in 5 minutes if you caught everyone on a good day. But for some reason, a galaxy class with a crew, it's a massive crew and that thing, can evacuate itself in under 5 minutes. And bear in mind, they faff a lot as well. That was quite surprising, I suppose, using lots of transporter. But it was a well-done scene, I thought. The evacuation was good. And kind of the bit where Riker and Picard kind of work out what's going on with the self-destruct and that sort of thing was quite neat as well. I could see you wouldn't like it. It does sag in the middle where everyone's just talking to Minuet. I think they maybe played her up. And also the idea that he goes back and it's like, oh no, there is the bit where we all just snigger where Riker asks how functional Minuet is. And it's, squeegee teams on standby. And Picard cock blocks him, and then afterwards it's, they just weren't the same, and it is that, no matter what combination, I couldn't get her back. And Picard says it would never have worked, she was an artificial hologram, and you really need to get out more. And that's really it. But for season one, it's not bad. We've seen worse this season, we've seen some better. I'd say this one's decent enough. But that's my opinion on this, so I'll be back shortly to talk about Too Short a Season. Until then, bye for now.
Bye, thank you, sir. Yes, I think for season one, it's not that bad. May well be a reoccurring theme at this point.
I was going to say, we've already established that this would apparently be, well, certainly this week, is the higher watermark.
Yeah.
I agree with the whole, it's the effect shots at the beginning really do look good. And, it's an established trope within Star Trek that if you want to make a new spaceship, you just make the same one but bigger.
Yeah, just put times two in everything.
Yeah, apparently that's it works fine. Absolutely fine.
The fact that you're a tiny dwarf on massive seats now, not an issue.
I'm just picturing now Worf or Gowron sitting on one of their bird of prey sort of thing, like that, just a massive chair, and they're just sitting there with his legs dangling over the end.
I can't reach the buttons.
I noticed with the evacuation, though, the Enterprise apparently has at least 20 transporter rooms.
I don't think it's unreasonable that using transporters, they can evacuate that quickly. And there are several docking.
Well, the cargo ones, they don't even have to stand on pads, do they? They just kind of mill and then do. Plus the transport, the evacuation tubes. And like all good cruise liners, I'm sure they occasionally do lifeboat musters. So, you know, the passengers will be fine.
And Precy Squares being Mornington Crescent. Yeah, I'm not buying that, really. I mean, considering the amount of armour that you have to wear for Precy Squares, and Mornington Crescent's never struck me as a full-contact sport, really.
I'm pretty sure it's Pyramid, and those blue things are just there to throw us off the scent.
Yeah.
They get there, they take them off, and Worf's just wearing a mankini. You're welcome.
Great. Okay, let's just see if Drew and Tracy can weird me out as much.
This is a feedback for 11001001.
Which translates to?
A 201.
Okay.
In decimal.
Fine. So what do we think of that?
I really enjoyed it, actually. It might be because we've been watching Battlestar Galactica, and it's just good to get back to Next Generation. I didn't think it was too terrible. It's cheesy, cheese-tastic season one, but yeah, it's all right. I enjoyed the nostalgia of it. Might not like 3 or 4 episodes in, we might be like going, oh, this is terrible, but yeah, good.
I think I have to agree with you on that because, as soon as the music came on, we like ranked it up.
Yeah,
and was
I
like,
know.
God, I haven't heard this for ages. This
I
is
know.
Such a good tune.
Nostalgically good, might not be.
And I really thought this was like a quite engaging episode. I don't think it was the bestest, but maybe
there's
like
a lot
you,
wrong
because we haven't seen it for a long time. I was just really like, yeah. No Beard Riker.
No.
No.
Obviously.
No. And it's just wrong.
And no Troy.
Where the fuck was Troy?
I don't know. She might have said, oh, Captain, I sense a deception from the binos.
Well, maybe that's why she's not in this episode, because it would have been over all too quickly.
Talking of the binos. Now, I know, like, Voyager and stuff like that gets, like, bumpy forehead of the week. It's black. But the binos are terrible, aren't they? They really are awful looking and behaving and everything.
Whoever came up with these kind of creation for these little beings was just, I think they were off on one. And so, like, the unified pair, I mean, what the fuck was that about? And, like, they turned out to be wrong-uns, or did they?
I don't know.
Really? They were just trying to defend their planet,
were
they?
Yeah, I guess so.
Really? So Riker's in the holosuite.
Yes.
He was really smooth.
He was smooth.
What's a jazz-loving girl doing in a place like this?
Yeah.
Oh, leave.
No, it's really bad.
He's a bit choosy with like his likes for women. I mean, how many women has he seen like that in the last however long? And he's a bit like, oh, no, well,
I don't
like
want
a blonde. Yeah. All right, love. And also, I have to say, that band was really shit because you could clearly see that the piano keys were not
moving. I know,
moving.
It wasn't moving, was he?
And when there was a right close-up on the drum and he had like the...
Here's a tip, if you're going to have a band that are miming, don't do close-ups of the hands and fingers and stuff, innit?
So Picard's got a personal relaxation lamp.
I know, I want one of them.
He said, I'm going to relax with it with some... He's going to go off and read, and for an instant I thought, oh, porn.
That's what?
Well, because that's kind
he's
of...
He's reading an archaeology book, although that might be porn.
I'm going to relax with my personal relaxation lamp. Yes. I just thought that was a bit rude. Why did the red alert not sound in the holosuite?
I don't know. They should have it in the holosuite, really, shouldn't they?
You know, if there is fucking an emergency...
Oh, unless the binars programmed it to not...
Maybe,
oh, yeah,
maybe.
Because
I was
could
like,
be.
There needs to be a rule where the captain and the number one are not in the holosuite together then, especially when the red alert has been kind of signalled by someone else, because
must think that the binars programmed it.
Okay, well, we'll go with that, because that would make sense. Mm. But they cannot do that. That's just silly.
No.
And also, surely... Geordi and Data know that Picard and Riker would never have left the ship without making sure that everybody had left. And also, they would have come out of their shell and sort of said, well, who has signalled red alert? Because Data didn't even have to put in some kind of heavy-duty code, did he?
He was just like, this
is Commander Data. Red alert.
It was an extreme situation, though, wasn't it? They only had, like, minutes left, so that's probably why they was just acting on impulse and that.
They must know that Picard would never have beamed off without making sure that
everyone was off. They was just in a rush, I think. I liked it when Picard contacts Starbase 74 or whatever it was, and he says to Data, like, oh, we're trying to find, we're trying to get the information, but we can't get it. And Data's like, oh, yeah, they're binars. You need to be looking for, like, a file, like, yeah, that's got ones and zeros in it. It's like, really?
No, I just wanted Picard to go, no fucking shit, Sherlock. Come on.
No, it's just like, we didn't need to ask Data that information.
Really?
Yeah. But, yeah, you know, I enjoyed this.
I enjoyed this. I didn't realise it was the 10th episode in.
I don't know what it was. The 10th, so that's 2 in binary.
Oh, piss off.
But, yeah, this is good. Good stuff.
I enjoyed it. I thought that was good entertainment.
But let's leave it there.
Indeedy doodies. See you later.
Bye.
Yes, there are lots of Troy-free episodes in season one, curiously.
I merely assume that throughout the course of this episode, she was putting on the makeup that she's wearing in the next episode.
Yes, that's possibly why. Yeah. Or eating lots of chocolate, alternatively.
Yeah. I will say that as far as they know Picard and Riker wouldn't leave before everyone else. This is still very early in season one, or maybe halfway through season one, but they don't necessarily know that Picard would do that.
Yeah. Mm.
For all they know, the first sign of trouble, they're gone.
Yeah, I'm out of it. Yeah, I thought the binos looked okay. I said the costumes and that, but makeup was all right.
I think the makeup was okay.
Compare it to bloody Herpy and Jerpy or whatever they were in bloody Battlestar Galactica, those crap robots. Ugh. Now that's crap.
Yes, let's not, yeah.
But I think
where are you up to on Galactica now?
We're literally going to do the last two episodes of the season.
Okay, fine. Phew.
So, yes, nearly. Then we've got a whole 2 months of 1980.
Ooh. Yeah, lucky you.
Yeah. Anyway.
You'll be longing for Herpy and Jerpy then.
Yeah. The binars, I think you can assume, were blocking Picard and Riker as part of their plan. And as for Picard's porn, well, perhaps that's something for the new series.
Maybe that's why he went down to the holodeck. He suddenly realised that he didn't need his personal relaxation light. There was something else going on down there.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. And we've heard from the Llama God.
Llama God Lark, Scott Date, Noijik, Kirk, Fikasi, yeah. My God is full of jazz. Okay, well, we're returning to The Next Generation then, apparently, with episode 201. Or maybe episode Weird Bendy Pipe Box Corner Thing. Yeah, that's what 11001001 is in either decimal or as an ASCII character. I'm sure there's some sort of significance there, and they didn't just make it up on the fly. Definitely not. So this then is really what I would call classic Next Generation and classic Star Trek, in that we've got quite a high concept idea here. We've got binary bonded individuals who communicate using computers, and, you know, there's the whole death of civilization thing going on, whilst at the same time also playing host to some of old man Roddenberry's perversions. So, yeah, a bit of a mixed bag, this one, really, isn't it? But certainly classic Trek. Now, the central part of the story, the bit with the binos, is really an interesting story, even if the fact that, you know, they've had to fill the main computer with the knowledge of an entire civilization to save it, that seems a little bit familiar. Where have we heard that before? Or more precisely, when will we hear this again? Interesting. But it's certainly an interesting idea, and the binos are binary bonded to a computer. Odd that, obviously, in Discovery, no one said, hey, maybe Leland's the rise of the binars, given their, you know, computer-humanoid synthesis things, but now everyone goes for the Borg. But, yeah, the binos were there first. Also odd in that the idea of the binos is kind of quaint now, because obviously a decade later the Matrix would do the whole idea of humanoids paired with computers as well. I mean, obviously this whole idea has been explored in science fiction a lot more efficiently. The fact that the characters make so much about the fact that the binos are thinking and processing things quicker than mere biological meat sacks could. But then we get to Voyager several years later, and Voyager has been outfitted with bow neural gel packs, because the thinking at the time, at least in terms of real world science, was that biological processes could be even quicker than electronic digital processes. So it's at least interesting to see how fiction has progressed in terms of mirroring real-world technological advances. And yet, this does render it a little bit quaint, but it's still an interesting idea. And the fact that the binars are not trusting, no, it's just an interesting, you know, little morality tale we've got going on there. And it certainly makes a nice change that the aliens of the week who are stealing the Enterprise are not actually the bad guys. They're actually doing it for their own reason. They're just a little bit wary, and I really like that as an idea. And the fact that Picard is good with them, you know, and obviously Picard's going to be good with them. Obviously he's going to act to save them because Picard's just a good guy. So yeah, no, I do enjoy that whole side of things, even if the whole Enterprise crew are slightly patronising towards the binos in a way, really. The other part of the episode is, of course, Riker's horrible wank fantasy. Jo hasn't seen a lot of TNG before, and she was suffering this episode whilst I was watching it. I wasn't suffering, by the way. And she did ask, why doesn't he just go and shag a real woman? Yeah, well, that's a very interesting question, isn't it? So here we have the very first sign of something that would come to afflict the whole Enterprise crew down the line, is that they're all deeply disturbed, and that the cleanup crews for the holodeck do have the worst job on the ship. So again, I guess this was probably something interesting to play with in in 1987 terms, but again, watching it now, we've had The Matrix and so on and so forth, so can't judge it based on that. But this is definitely a male power fantasy, as you've got two older men clearly lecturing over another woman as if she's not really there, which I guess in this instance she isn't, but the fact that they respond to her when she does talk as if she's an actual person shows that they at least acknowledge her existence as a thinking being, but then they talk about her as if she's not there, as if she's property, and that's definitely a very misogynistic and dismissive thing, and unfortunately it is still something that's a reflection on how people, particularly the writers of the episode, I guess, and definitely the producers, view women. So yeah, it's very unsettling, those scenes. Even if it is meant to be an exploration of the human condition, then it doesn't paint a very positive picture of what the human condition actually is. The biggest disappointment about the whole episode, though, of course, is the fact that when they dock at Starbase 43, whichever one it was, I think it was 43, is that the evil Picard clone that comes aboard doesn't turn out to be an evil Picard. No, really, why do they cast a guy who looks just like Patrick Stewart, but with an evil universe goatee? I know the Next Generation never did the evil universe, but that would be the perfect time to start. What is good about the episode is that the whole space dock sequence does look great in Blu-ray. I mean, yeah, I know we're reusing footage from Star Trek 3 and everything. We do see some of the same shots twice, or maybe in reverse. But hey, they look great. They look fantastic, and I love those shots. Even if the Enterprise entering space dock is accompanied by a weird sound effect, which I'm sure is meant to be the doors opening, but it sounds like they've kind of just scraped through the opening a bit. That's a bit unfortunate. There is one oddity in that the engineering computer, especially when confirming the countdown, I'm very disappointed there's no destruct, zero, zero destruct. I mean, come on, can't they even get those little details right? It was weird to see that the engineering computer was talking with a male voice as opposed to a female voice. Because we definitely see a computer talking with two different voices, so that's a bit of an oddity. Maybe something to do with the binos? I don't know if this ever happens again during Next Generation. And there is a glorious little moment when, after the Enterprise has been stolen, they have the conversation, you know, we need to send a ship to intercept the Enterprise. We'll send the Enterprise, she's the only ship in the quadrant that can... Oh, bugger. That's the Enterprise's own heritage, catching up with it right there, or getting away from itself, one of the two. I don't know. But anyway, this was not a bad episode, definitely one with a lot of problems, but very indicative of the time and era in which it was made, and which really should have been titled Riker Gets His Bone. Anyway, let's see what the next one's like.
Yeah. I think Old Man Roddenberry's Perversions might be the episode title.
yeah, that, I can see that.
And why would you show this to Joe, for heaven's sake? It's this great series. You've seen Discovery. Now watch right. Oh, my gosh. This is about as far removed from Discovery as you can get. So in terms of sexual politics, blimey.
It was the 80s. Not a defence, yeah. But... an explanation.
Yeah, no, it wasn't acceptable in the 80s either. It was damn creepy then. People generally have sort of got the most out of these episodes, I think, more so than I've managed in many ways, but there we go. Right, we're ready to take a plunge.
Well,
in quality.
That's an interesting choice of terminology there.
Yeah.
If we're going to do that, well, I'm going to need a stiffer drink.
Right. To the booze cabinet.
Next time on Star Trek The Next Generation.
I'm strong, I'm locked, I'm getting younger.
A dying commander takes a youth drug to fight terrorists holding hostages. Oh! But will dangerous side effects jeopardize their mission?
If we don't deliver Jameson in 5 minutes, one of the hostages will be executed.
Sir, look out!
Find out on Star Trek The Next Generation.
Too short a season, too long an episode. Here we go.
I've switched to hard liquor.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. And appropriately enough, for this features Admiral Mark Jameson. So I hope you've got your whiskey to hand.
It's a White Russian.
Yeah, of course it is. But of course. Yes, the Enterprise is at Persephone 5, where they're due to pick up the good Admiral.
That's a terrible name for a planet.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? Yeah, it's funny we don't revisit that one. Yeah. He's played by Clayton Rohner, which is a German-sounding name.
Are you sure he's not played by a really bad set of old man makeup?
It is mainly at this stage bad makeup. For reasons, I mean, there are reasons why he's under age makeup. There's no excuse for it being so bad, I can't help feeling. I mean, for heaven's sake, the original series did this better in, was it The Deadly Years, where the crew all age?
I think so. I think... a combination of the cast were generally older anyway.
That helps, I guess.
This guy's 12, I think.
He is pretty much, isn't he?
And the other thing I can't help but notice, and this was very apparent on the Netflix HD ones, they haven't done any makeup or anything to his hands.
Ah.
So, it's just... When you look at... when we do it now with aged makeup effects, a film... I won't mention for spoilers, but a film we have recently seen, everyone.
Yeah.
It's like the most amazing film. Well, not amazing. Successful film of recent time. Marvellous, wasn't it? Yes. Has some fantastic age makeup on a particular character. And it was just like, I fully buy that they just found someone who looked exactly like that actor, but aged 40 years and brought him in.
I mean, you've got to, as I say, you've got to give it some leeway for this is the 1980s, but nevertheless, I actually did it better in the 60s.
Yeah. So apparently there was some regression taking place at some point.
Yeah. Anyway, this dude was in the X-Files, you never guessed. The showmakers recognised that the makeup looked rubbish, but yeah, what are you going to do too late at this point? Mm-hmm. We get our first view of the standard Admiral's uniform, as opposed to the dress one that Q sported in Hyde and Q.
This is, if I'm correct, is this our first Admiral?
Arguably, yes, if you don't count Q.
No, I don't think we can count him. And this is a... I want to mention, so it's terrible old man makeup.
Yeah.
Terrible old man acting.
Yeah.
And a terrible uniform.
In a terrible wheelchair as well. So
well, you say that.
Joker broke.
You say that on a wheelchair. You'll notice it is upholstered to match the bridge of the Enterprise.
It is. But unfortunately, they made a wheelchair that didn't actually move, as becomes very apparent.
Yeah. And again, in the 60s, we had this with Pike.
Yes. And it, yes, despite looking perhaps clunkier, at least that one damn well moved. Oh, dear. So, yes, the Admiral's uniforms do improve by about season 3, but they have several attempts along the way. It's Picard shows him a message from Governor Karnas of Morden 4, who definitely sounds like something from Babylon 5, doesn't
it? And in another classic Anne Marie, I know him from somewhere, but yep. I couldn't tell you where.
You do indeed. Okay, there's a bit of a list here, actually. Michael Pataki, who was Klingon Korax in The Trouble with Tribbles.
Ah.
He's the one who picks a fight with Scotty in the bar. Hence, he's
the
also
Enterprise should be hauled away as garbage.
That's the dude, yes. He was also in 60s Batman, and Batman the Animated Series, obviously just a voice in that case. Mission Impossible, Easy Rider, BJ and the Bear. Always a favourite here. TJ Hooker.
He
Auto
must
Man.
Have been an A-team. He must have been an
A-team. You know, I didn't see an A-team reference, but it's probably just because I overlooked it, I'm sure.
Okay.
Rocky 4 and Halloween 4.
Ah.
Yeah, so he obviously featured in films that only, number 4 in the series. I mean, he's a tad hammy here, isn't he? Let's face it. It's not his finest moment, I'm sure.
He's chewing on some scenery, for sure.
Yeah, he could get away with it in the original series because he was hamming it up as a minor Klingon role. But in this one, a lot of it centres around him and it's not good.
No.
We also see the two big eagles last seen in Q's court in his office.
Mm. And a wide selection of weapons previously seen in Star Trek 2 and 3.
Exactly, yes. Which makes sense, continuity-wise. And a sort of very basic Klingon disruptor rifle as well. I think they tweak it quite a bit the next time we see it.
It's the back of Kirk's rifle from Star Trek 3. But you know, when they're about to board the Enterprise and they're all going out, they kind of bolt it on, it's the back end mounted on something else.
Aha, that explains why part of it looked familiar. Okay, and also looked Klingon. Yeah. He's demanding that Admiral Whiskey comes to Mordan to negotiate for the release of some Federation diplomats. So far, so vaguely exciting.
Really?
Vaguely. Say vaguely.
Yes, you did.
And it gets less exciting as it goes on. Apparently, Whiskey resolved a similar situation over 40 years ago, so good for him. We get a rare view of the 4 turbo lift. As Picard and Riker go to welcome the Admiral aboard. This is about as exciting as this episode gets.
Although, we did see that in the previous episode.
Did we?
We did. Data and Geordi went on to it after they programmed the automatic...
they used that one, did they?
Yes, they did. Uh-huh. So there you go, twice in as many episodes we use the emergency turbo lift.
They're getting their money's worth at this stage. Yeah, then we get the first view is a wheelchair, which costs $10,000.
What?
$10,000 for a wheelchair that couldn't move.
Jesus Christ.
And this is the reason why Melora, in Deep Space Nine's Season 2 episode with the same name, mm-hmm. got an obviously 20th century chair. They'd learnt their lesson. Do not build a custom chair. It costs lots of money and will not work.
But again, in Season bloody whatever of original series, Pike had a working...
Season 1, yeah. I mean... It didn't look great, but at least it worked, yes.
Yeah. Madness.
We also meet Anne Jameson, who's played by Marsha Hunt, who'd been appearing in films since 1937, but then was blacklisted during the McCarthy era.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and her Wikipedia entry is really interesting. In the midst of the Blacklist era, Hunt became active in the humanitarian cause of world hunger, and in later years has aided homeless shelters, supported same-sex marriage, raised awareness of climate change, and promoted peace in third world countries.
Oh, good on her.
Yeah, we salute you, Marcia Hunt.
That's
impressive.
Right. Yeah.
Best things come out
this episode, it would seem.
Yeah, and she's still alive. She's 102.
Whew.
Yeah, unless they haven't updated the wiki in case... rather embarrassingly, she's died recently. But anyway.
Oh. Well, let's hope not.
Yes.
I raise a glass to you, Mrs. Whiskey.
Yes. Okay, we're going to need more of that. Anyway, the Admiral demands control of the away team, which does not go down with Picard and co. And that's our rather underwhelming teaser, it has to be said. In order to fit the bulky chair onto the bridge, we discover they've removed Riker's console.
Mm-hmm.
Just pulled it out. Sparks everywhere, and they make use of Troy to get an impression of whether Karnas is hiding anything when he hails, which is good, you know.
And they've clearly interrupted her geisha recital, which she was taking part in right. 10 forward or whatever was in 10 forward before 10 forward, because they have caked the makeup on her in this. I mean, my god, man.
It's that gun from The Simpsons.
It really is. It's the bloody it was the makeup gun. It was
just, yeah. But, you know, it's nice. She admits most of her assessment is based on body language because, you know, she's miles, billions and zillions of miles away, whereas elsewhere in season one, she seems to be able to pick up emotions from a hell of a long way. But anyway, no, she's going on body language. It's good. We like this.
Mm-hmm.
We get a very, very talky scene about the background of the conflict. And, yes, we get an awful lot of talky scenes in this. Director Rob Bowman was disappointed by just how talky the script was, but he was lumbered with it. So what are you going to do?
Mm.
There is quite a sweet scene as Anne reflects sadly on how if the Federation had had Galaxy-class ships in his day, they could have spent more time together. So, it's quite a nice. But Whiskey is clearly in pain, but fobs her off with some guff about body changes or something. Yes.
What I just want to say, it's very apparent here, though, the difference in age and ability between
the acting.
Yeah. Because he is doing some fucking atrocious old man acting with his kind of gurning non-stop and everything. It's just so bad.
Brent Spiner levels of...
Oh, it really is.
That was it.
Maybe this is where he learnt it from.
Maybe. Yes, he takes some acting classes from this idiot. Anyway, Crusher is complaining that Whiskey has given her old medical data. Strokey chin. To the accompaniment of very ominous music, Whiskey leaves his chair behind to take the gun.
And this guy's a fake. A fucking Goldbreaker.
Stay away from me, mister!
This guy fucking walks. I've never been more certain of anything in my life.
You stay away from me!
Walter,
I've never been more certain of anything in my fucking life.
Come on!
Walter, put him down, man!
Yeah, I'll put him down, dude!
So everything goes back to Lebowski.
Absolutely.
Suspicious Crusher is even more suspicious as the Admiral shouldn't be able to walk again. In his quarters, Whiskey starts getting frisky with Anne, which is really embarrassing. And she realises he looks 20 years younger. Well, yeah, the makeup isn't quite so bad at this point, but that's about it, yes.
Mm.
And then he ends up on the floor in pain. Good. Anyway, Crusher has found something alien in his system, which could have been quite interesting, but it's just a thing that we never find out much about, but his disease is gone.
Yes, and we never hear of it again, ever.
Yes. When Picard goes to get some answers, the Admiral admits to using a dangerous and painful rejuvenation process.
Twice.
Yes. Yes. Monkey semen or something. I don't know what it is, but anyway. When the captain leaves, Anne rips her husband a new one for not telling her anything, quite understandably. He hails Karnas and calls his bluff, realising that it's him that has the hostages. And Mordan is clearly a long, long, long way away, as Enterprise journeys don't normally take this long, but we're still not there yet. We should have cut away to lots of scenes of Wesley going, are we there yet? Are we there yet?
There'll be lots more scenes of Riker on the holodeck.
Yeah. Well, yes, it still would have been better than this. Whiskey tells the bridge crew he's going to lead an armed rescue mission to get the hostages, because of course he is, because that's the Federation. Yeah. Anne is pouring out her woes to Crusher and Troy. They break the news that her husband isn't making the miracle recovery he was expecting. It's all going a bit Pete Tong. Rona is now Sol's makeup completely, as he described what happened 40 years ago with Karnas. Apparently he saved the hostages by giving arms to Karnas and the opponents in a rather unique approach to the Prime Directive. Bloody hell, he's worse than Kirk.
Yeah. Also, was this sanctioned by Starfleet? Because otherwise...
You get the impression he didn't hand in any paperwork for this.
Yeah.
Just came back and said, oh, it's all gone wrong.
Yeah. Well, all those weapons you requisitioned are lost.
Yeah. I mean, it's something, I'm sure. Never mind. Yeah. The arms for hostages part of the plot was inspired by the Iran-Contra affair. Remember that?
No.
Vaguely, but only because I wasn't quite as young as you at the time. It was where the Reagan administration had been selling arms to Iran, despite an international embargo, in order that 7 hostages might be freed. You know, back in the days when Reagan seemed like the worst president ever.
how I miss those innocent times.
Helicopter days, yeah. But hey, we're about to end up with the worst prime minister ever, I suspect, so who are we to criticise? Unless he ends up in court, of course, in which case I shall laugh. We might be date stamping this slightly, but anyway, let's move on. Picard rightly points out an admiral shouldn't be going on an away mission. Well, hell no. In fact, I'm pretty sure there are regulations about that back in Wrath of Khan, weren't there? About flag officers beaming down without an armed escort.
There's no such regulation, but...
And then in a two wrongs don't make a right approach, Picard insists on accompanying him. It's like, oh, really?
I mean, it's pretty clear at this point he is unfit for command. You know, he's under the influence of some unknown bloody drug. He's admitted to, you know, arms dealing. I think there's enough grounds here at this point for Picard to relieve him of duty.
You'd think, but that's never the way these things go, is it?
Yeah,
that's
true.
30 minutes in, pretty much nothing has happened, it has to be said.
Oh, there's been some atrocious old man acting.
Yeah, but it's not really what we're watching Trek for, let's face it.
No, definitely not.
They beam down to a tunnel set that looks exactly the same as the Farpoint Station ones. I suspect they're the same ones. They just
Is it a proto-cave?
Yeah, basically. Yeah, Next Generation does the cave. I know these tunnels like the back of my hand, the Admiral says. Yeah, yeah. Because that worked well in Star Trek V, didn't it? Except there isn't a comedy moment here. Aboo. But what there is a wall sealed off that they have to cut through. And then they're under attack and we finally at least have some action anyway. During which... we have a matte set extension. Oh, we're going to get excited about mats now.
Oh, I like a good matte painting.
Oh, yes, rub your knees. Yes, this was used in the classic film Spaceballs. Bloody hell.
Well, there goes the planet.
Yeah, quite. There goes the podcast, I think. Data points out their attackers' phases are set on kill.
Sorry. Can you please play out to the Spaceballs theme?
Do I have to?
Yeah, please,
really?
Please.
I actually can't remember what the Spaceball... Oh, no, it's just horrible in the 80s, isn't it?
Do it!
It's just literally Spaceballs! Watch out!
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh, do you think this episode deserves anything better? Of course not.
Mm-hmm. Well, this episode probably doesn't. 1101, possibly, but anyway. Picard wearily points out that he's heard the sound of phases on kill before. It's this whole thing, particularly in early Next Generation, where... Picard just pissed off with Data constantly.
It's very nonchalant, isn't it? You go, my phases are set to kill, sir. Yes, I've heard them on kill before, thank you.
It's pretty much up there with they're firing, sir, they're firing. Yes, you will point out if they hit me at any point, won't you? The Admiral collapses and Picard orders an emergency beam out, not a moment too soon. Riker asks how the Admiral is and Picard says, not good is a galactic understatement. Which pretty much sums up the entire episode.
Yeah, a little bit.
Karnas demands the Admiral is beamed down and threatens to kill the hostage every 5 minutes. So we're definitely in the 80s, aren't we? Mm-hmm. The Admiral wants to be beamed down and Picard agrees. But of course, Karnas doesn't recognise Jameson without the infeasible makeup, which apparently that qualifies as a cliffhanger because it goes to an advert at that point. Wow. I mean, it's odd because he saw him when he was young, so he should realise it's him.
You think so, yeah.
Yeah. The city you see outside his window is a model rather than a mat. A rather expensive option that, let's face it, isn't 100% effective. Picard tries to persuade Karnas by giving a slideshow of his de-aging, but it takes the Admiral showing him his scar for now.
He's very lucky that this age-reversing drug didn't erase, like, old scars, which, you know, often is a thing which happens in these things.
Yes, which then finally persuades the governor. Karnas goes to shoot his nemesis, but decides to watch him die from his de-aging treatment. And he dies in Anne's arms. Aboo. or something. No, actually, we don't give a shit.
No, we don't. I'll tell you what's a boo. Marsha Hunt deserved a better episode of Star Trek than this.
He did, a better role, definitely.
Because she's bringing her game. She is great. I really like the scenes with her, Troy, and Crusher.
That is a nice scene.
It's a nice scene. Although, I have to say, Troy did seem to be on his side.
Yeah.
A little bit. But she deserved a better Star Trek episode than this.
And let's face it, so did we.
Absolutely. Yes, we
because
did.
Because that's literally the end. The Admiral dies and Karnas releases the hostages. End of episode. Whoop-de-doo. Massive build-up.
He's almost quite congenial at that point, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, he cooled down completely. It's way too slow. It's way too talky.
Yes.
As you pointed out, some of the acting is shocking.
Oh, right. It's so shocking.
It's crying out for a B-plot, basically, to try and put some excitement in it. But heaven knows, I mean, it'd probably be Riker in the bloody holosuite again. So
it probably would have been. Also, during our one action scene when they go into the tunnel set, and they come across the dead end wall, and they pull out their phasers, you can see the perforated line where they're cutting through.
Yeah. That's a common thing on Doctor Who as well.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Generally, when I watch episodes, I take screenshots to put on Tumblr, and I try to get at least a week's worth out of an episode. I managed all of 2 screenshots for this entire episode.
I would say it's quite telling how long we talked about 201 compared to how long we talked about this episode.
Indeed. Yes, I think it says it all, really.
Yeah.
It's a pile of poo. And it's not the worst pile of poo we've got to cover either, which is a bit worrying, but never mind.
You're really not selling... I mean, I suppose you at this point, you're figuring if the people are on board, they've been on board and they're going to see it through because you're really not selling it.
No, but there's no way to sell this shite, is there, really? I mean, it's shocking.
You know what I would have quite liked, though?
Yeah?
Season 7 of Next Gen is pretty shocking, isn't it?
It is.
It is truly shocking. I would have loved an episode where we get Mrs. Jameson comes back for some other reason, I don't care what, but we maybe pick up on her life later on and see what's going on. Just bring back Marsha Hunt for that. That would have been good.
Hell, I mean, Crusher could have fallen in love with her instead of an Irish ghost. I mean, that would have been an improvement.
I'm on board for that.
Or was it a Scottish ghost? I forget now, but it was very, very badly done. It was Scottish, wasn't it? Because we got Curry on to cover that episode.
It was Scottish, yes.
Yeah, it's inverted commas. Anyway, let's find out what Dory made of this episode. Boy, am I glad the Next Generation writers got better. This premise was just plain weak, and this episode has a massive plot hole. When the army dictator guy asked the admiral, who was de-aged, to show him the scar from when they'd sealed the deal, there was a scar to show. The dictator guy had known the admiral when he was that young. Surely you shouldn't have had so much trouble recognizing him. Exactly. And while I'm on the subject, why did 3 still frame photos of the admiral's de-aging process convince the army guy? Yeah. It is crap. You're right, Dory.
It's not good. Although, interesting side note, one of the writers for this was DC Fontana.
Yes, but I think this is one of the ones that Roddenberry's lawyer got his fingers into. And do you know the story about this slimy lawyer
This is Chaos on the Bridge, isn't it, deals with this?
That's right, yes, it does in a big way. And also there's the recent history guides to Star Trek, which came out for the 50th anniversary. Yeah, this guy was just in meddle with scripts on behalf of Roddenberry, supposedly, because Roddenberry was just off playing golf or shagging somebody he shouldn't be. And he just inserted his own lines in it. He was the one who was really keen on Wesley. And yes, he inserted a load of lines in here, and DC Fontana found out and unsurprisingly hit the roof. So, yeah.
And it also feels a lot like, as a lot of season 1 episodes do, a phase 2 script.
Yeah, yes, I can't help feeling we dodged a bullet on phase 2, didn't we, not having it?
I feel a little bit.
Yeah, because that would have been prime Roddenberry yuck, I can't help feeling, but there we are. Right, let's find out what the Llama God made of this.
Llama God's Lark, supplemental. Why can't we all just make up? Right, well, this is certainly an episode of Next Generation, isn't it? Yeah, not particularly its finest hour, I would say. The main striking thing during this episode is, of course, the makeup. And actually, not just makeup from Bad and More Bad makeup job and horrible, horrible old age acting. I mean, Christ, that's how we start the episode, with someone who, with very, very unconvincing bad aging makeup and very much drama school acting to be old. It's awful. So at least it pays off. It's not like in Prometheus where we have Guy Pearce under loads of latex for no reason because they can be bothered
Trouble to actually put the scenes with his younger self in the episode. So at least that pays off, and I guess it's one of those things where it's dated over time. It looks dated now, and maybe it looks worse on Blu-ray, but I don't know. One of the other weird things about it, though, if we're going to talk about makeup, which I am, because this is my feedback, so I can do what I like, although you can edit it so you can do what you like, so I guess we're a bit of a stalemate there, is that having not really watched a lot of the Blu-ray episodes yet, I was quite surprised with how much makeup everyone is wearing. Especially Troy, I never realised, you know, on broadcast, because of course I wouldn't on broadcast, is how much makeup she was actually made to wear. Bloody hell, it's awful. But then again, I guess this was the 80s, even if it was the space 80s. But yeah, so yeah, I'm mostly talking about makeup because, yeah, you know what, the actual plot is not very interesting. I mean, okay, I guess it had the potential to be interesting. It does have this kind of feel like a lot of the early TNG episodes do, where the distant reaches of the Federation or Federation space are slightly more dangerous. I think as we progress into Next Generation, Federation starts to become a lot safer and a lot more familiar. But definitely during the early series, and, you know, when we talk about Tasha Yar's home colony and everything, we find out that there are definitely very dodgy areas, as is going on here. I guess it has the potential to be an interesting story. We're discovering that the famed negotiator, who is now the Admiral, is actually responsible for a massacre because he made a bad decision. I mean, I guess that in itself is interesting. Unfortunately, that's kind of undone by just having a really lousy actor portraying him. I mean, you'd forgive it if he was decent and charismatic as a younger character, but he's just not. And then there's the second storyline, which is the Fountain of Youth, which I'm pretty sure this isn't the first time that Star Trek has done this. No, definitely won't be the last time. Perhaps someone should have sent him to see the Baku. That wouldn't have perhaps gone quite so badly. But yeah, okay, interesting enough ideas. Unfortunately, the Enterprise cast do take a bit of a backseat in this episode, apart from Picard, who gets to stand around a little bit more, and he does actually go down on an away mission, and Riker doesn't really object very much, even though they send him into a war situation, and into a really, really crap ambush. These tunnel scenes have done really well, but honestly, they had the away team pinned down, and instead of actually catching the crossfire and killing everyone, which they could have done really easily, they instead visibly come and jump and roll in through some of the tunnel entrances, giving the away team time to hide, so that was a bit of a daft decision. So, you know, it's got some good moments, but ultimately this is a lot more of a forgettable one than the previous episode. Solid core concepts, I guess, but just not particularly well executed. At least it does end with the amusing line, with Picard saying, "The quest for youth is a futile one," shortly before, I guess, going off to browse the latest Argo manual for his next away mission, Dune Buggy or something. I don't know. Still, this has been interesting to rewatch these episodes in light of having just come off the back of Discovery. Obviously two very different series, so I'll be interested to hear what everyone else thinks. And until the next dive into the past, glory to you and your cast.
Thank you, sir. Yes, if something's reminding you of Insurrection, that's never a good sign.
Yeah. Interesting note that they have this planet which will effectively cure aging, the whole Fountain of Youth sort of thing, and again, never mentioned again. You know, cure all the diseases and everything in the entirety of the Federation, and now we're going to go and evict the Baku from their planet, which, yeah. I sent feedback in for Insurrection. It's not good.
Yes, I think that was a lesson we all learned. And yes, it's also slightly better than Prometheus, which again isn't saying an awful lot.
Excuse me. It is on the record that there are multiple casts on how much I hate Prometheus. Mm. I would watch Prometheus every single day over having to watch this thing again.
Really?
At least it looks good.
Well, things happen, I guess. Mm. It has that, even if they make no sense at all, at least there is stuff actually happening on screen.
Yes.
This is pretty much half an hour of nothing happening.
Yep.
And then a brief phase of fight before then the antagonist just gives up in a second.
And I do think if they had gotten a better, more charismatic actor in to play Jameson,
it may have worked.
It may have worked. Because part of the problem is, even when he's in the old man makeup, you know, there's no reason for Picard to respect him or anything. It's just
no. Apparently, it was a thing that nobody got on with the actor on set either, so that didn't help.
Well,
so
he looks like a cock anyway.
Yeah. So, okay, who would we recast this as to try to improve things?
Well, is it today or is it from back in the 80s?
I suppose technically back in the 80s, so yeah, that's a bit more difficult, isn't it?
It does make it more difficult.
Because there wasn't a lot of genre shows on back then, so I wouldn't know. It'd be somebody from the A-Team or the X-Files, let's face it.
I'll tell you who I think could make it work.
Yeah?
Andrew Robinson.
Yeah, yeah.
We know he can act really well under makeup.
Yeah.
And I think he's the person who's charismatic enough that he can do the serious stuff as well. You get someone like Andrew Robinson or everyone's favourite Star Trek extra, Jeffrey Combs. One of those regulars could have made this work. But this guy,
new. How about new?
Okay.
Let's hear what Drew and Tracy made of this one.
So that was the second episode we've just watched called Too Short a Season.
It was.
And your thoughts on that were?
Yeah, back to not as great.
There's really not very much.
It was too talky, wasn't it? There was just not enough like exciting stuff going on.
It was just, as soon as you saw him, old man Biff from Back to the Future, I have to put it in there because that's what he looked like. You know, you kind of knew that he wasn't a writer. And like Troy is sitting on the bridge looking at him with her really suspicious eyes. And I'm like, you don't need to be fucking empathic to know that there is something not quite right. I sussed that the minute I see him.
I could completely remember this, but even really? So, yeah, 100%. But just looking at him, you're just like, that doesn't look like a normal human being.
It's not that he didn't look like a normal human being, but just the way that he was acting, you knew that there was kind of some story there and he wasn't kind of being truthful. And you just, it was a bit obvs that was going to come out.
And also, when they first saw him, when he says, what time will you be born? He says, oh, 1500. And then there's Admiral Jameson out. And then Data goes, oh, it's almost 1500 now. And Picard goes, oh, let's go to the transporter room to meet him. Why didn't he just say, oh, I'll beam over right now? What was that about?
And you're asking me? I don't know. What? I don't have an answer. I didn't do it. When they beam over to see Karnos and they start fighting, when like the away team go, it was like fucking paintball.
I know.
Karnos's men were dressed as paintball people.
And but I tell you what we liked.
What?
Dustbusters. I love the Dustbusters.
We actually did start singing. You said, oh, they're using Dustbusters again. And we did start singing it's great. The theme.
It's good.
Love the fact that Karnos is wearing Tetris badges.
Yes, he was, wasn't he? We really could see him at the end. I know. He's got a lot of medals for playing Tetris there, isn't he? Terrible 80s synth soundtrack,
isn't
it?
You kept saying that, but I wasn't really picking it up.
Awful synthesized trumpets through it. I was just like, it's awful.
There was just nothing for Riker to do in this.
No, I
know. Apart from kind of give Picard not the sly eye, but kind of like the side eye when he was making his decisions and things like that, and kind of giving over.
Picard should have put his foot down, shouldn't he? He's like,
but
he
says, Jameson was an admiral,
he falsified my reports and he's taking this drug to make him young.
And that's what I said
Picard
to you.
Should have just gone, hold
at that
on,
point, why
you
couldn't
might be
he
an admiral,
put him in the brig and sort of said, you're in contempt of whatever, I don't know.
Yes.
But, you know, you've gone against the Federation, you need to fucking stand down.
He should have.
But actually, put his foot down, right? Picard should have been like, you might be an admiral, but this is my ship. And
he did say that, didn't he? So I'm the captain, I go on board. But he should have stopped him, definitely, 100%. There's lots of terrible overacting at the end. When Karnos and Jameson, the pair of them are terrible actors.
Yeah.
Patrick Stewart, he's about 11 episodes or something into Next Generation.
Yeah.
He must have just been going, what am I doing here? And a brilliant act on him and these guys, especially that Karnos, he was going, I can't believe it's you. Oh, yes, that's not you. This is some kind of destruction. It's just like terrible overacting.
Who is it you sound like there?
I don't know, but I'm surprised Patrick Stewart didn't just walk off this set and go, no more.
He's a lovey, to be fair.
Just awful acting in this from them two.
So we knew that Jameson was actually going to start regenerating.
Yeah, well,
is it regenerating the right word? But kind of, you know, going
youthful,
backwards.
Yeah.
We did at some point say, is he going to end up sperm on a chair?
I know. You know, when I really hoped, like when Beverly at the end was scanning him and she goes, I'm afraid there's nothing I can do. He's going to become a sperm. That would have been so good, wouldn't it? But no.
This was a bit bleh.
Yeah, too talky.
Yeah.
Terrible soundtrack, terrible effects, overacting. Not the best.
And Picard was a bit snappy with Data. Yes, yeah. I know that, Mr. Data.
I recognise that sound, yeah.
And Geordi had too much soul glow in his hair.
I know,
at the end of this episode, his hair was glittery, wasn't it?
He was
shining.
I know.
See, it's just 80s.
It is.
Or is this early 90s? I don't know.
80s. This is 80s. Right. Yeah. Not the best, I'm afraid.
Not the best. But I bet other people disagree.
I wouldn't have thought
many. I think it's good. Anyway, leave it there.
Yep.
Take it easy. See you later. Bye.
Bye.
Ta-da.
Yes. Aging makeup in the 80s wasn't good, was it? And Biff is another example.
Yeah, Biff is a very good example. And that was before this as well. Biff was 84, 85?
Yeah, it must have been something like that, wasn't it?
Oh, and not only Biff, you've also got George McFly.
Yep.
And his mum. Yeah. So,
yeah.
Hell, Doc Brown.
To an extent, but yeah, it's not quite as bad as this. Mm. But that's part because Christopher Lloyd's a better actor. So
I just looked up the guy, Clayton, whatever his name is.
Yeah.
To give you a level of his acting ability, one of the more recent things he's been in was Human Centipede 3, The Final Sequence. Kind of sums it up there, doesn't it?
Ass to mouth sums him up.
Probably.
Yeah. Bloody hell. Mm. Okay, nice. Yeah, interestingly, originally the episode was going to end with Jameson de-aging to the age of 14. Before killing him, but they couldn't afford to do that, presumably.
What, kill a 14-year-old in the 80s?
Yeah, no, as in get another actor on, because they'd need to do that at that point. I just love the way this is like a very short-lived nostalgia hit for them. They got really excited about 101, and then this one here was like, oh, God. Yeah, it wasn't good, was it?
No, and next week isn't going to get any better.
No, it really, really isn't. But anyway.
You know how sometimes when you're watching something and you want to run to the next episode? Yeah, none of that this time.
No. Afraid not. Yeah. And Dustbusters should definitely have been a jingle had I thought about that back, you know, the millions of years ago when we covered some of the other first season episodes. But never mind. Purry will save us, I'm sure.
Hello again, Parry here to talk about Too Short a Season. Now, remember how I was actually okay with 11001001? Not so with Too Short a Season. Now, I actually watched both of these on the train using the magic of Netflix being able to download to my phone. I suppose we could say the episode's lost something being on a phone, but no. This one was just... it was kind of painfully dull. It meandered. I wasn't really sure what the point was, so did the bad admiral who comes in, who slowly gets younger and younger, sadly, I thought we were going to go full baby here. Sadly not. He gets down to the actor outside of increasingly less convincing age makeup, and then dies of younging. But meanwhile, there's some shiftiness with the head of this planet who took hostages but pretended he didn't. There's a plot somewhere in here, but I think it got muddied with... This almost seems like a whole lot of people came in with ideas and just got slung at it. So you had the idea of the de-aging drug, but it's maybe making him unstable. You've got the sort of mystery with this guy and the planet. But it never really worked as an episode. And to be honest, I found it crushingly boring. Genuinely, now bear in mind, I watch stuff on my way into work. I was dozing off. I had to watch myself on the way back in case I woke up in Alloa. Because, yeah, this was... And I wouldn't have watched this if I was on the Inverness train, because that's way too long to fall asleep and wake up past your house, let me tell you. But, I was struggling. I had to keep waking up, backing it up, and I was thinking maybe I'm overtired. But then once I'd finished watching it, I started watching... something more interesting, and no, I was awake. This was just crushingly boring, and I really can't say many good things about it. It's quite neat that Crusher and Troy talk to his wife, I suppose, although you could argue they got to talk to her because, you know, they're all women's, but really, I mean, I struggle to come up with anything at all to say about this. I can't even really get properly annoyed at it, because it didn't do anything... Well, it might have done horrible things, I don't know, I was dozing off. It probably did the biggest offence in anything, which was to be dull. And this one was... I can see why I can never remember what this episode's about, because it's utterly forgettable and utterly boring. But I got through it. It wasn't, I suppose, offensive, unlike, say, you know, Up the Long Ladder, or not Justice, what's that other one? The racist one, we'll just call it. That horribly racist one that we've already watched. So it wasn't offensive like those, this was just tedious. But well done, everyone who watched the episodes. My hats are off to you. So all it remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I always enjoy these podcasts. I'm very positive on your completist nature, and I hope to feedback next time you do it. But until then, bye for now.
Bye. Yes, at least it wasn't Code of Honor. Wow.
Yes, that's...
Yeah, between that and Justice, those are definitely the
This is definitely just a non-episode, isn't it?
It is boring. Yeah, and you're right. That's one of the worst things Trek can be, is boring. Mm-hmm. And yes, that's my memory of Home Soil, I'm afraid, which we're going to cover next time. Hey ho. But yeah. Sorry, guys. I did warn you this wasn't going to be easy.
and you didn't even enjoy 11001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001001
So, yes, when do we get to find out what we're watching next? Well, stand by for In Action as we cover When the Bough Breaks, which is a kiddie episode. That's pretty much all I remember about it, which is never a good thing, is it, really?
It's going to be Wesley heavy.
I rather suspect it will. And, yes, the aforementioned home soil, or night soil, possibly we could call
it. Is that the ugly bags of mostly water?
It is, and that's the best thing you can say about the episode, is that line.
There you go.
So, yeah. We shall be recording on, now, is it Thursday the 4th of July?
That's the current plan, yes.
Yes. But if things should change, we'll put it up on Twitter, but that's the current plan.
Put it this way, it's going to be in about a month's time, whatever happens.
Yeah. We need a big lead up for this.
It's going to take Pete that long for me to forget that I've agreed to do this.
Yes.
I'll do it again.
Well, I think it should be only fair as payment for putting you through this for you to be able to plug your other podcast, which would be infinitely more exciting than this. So go for it, sir.
I'd like to be humble and say, no, surely you jest, but no, straight up, they are a lot better than this season one of Next Gen. I suppose the most relevant one to the listeners here would be Into the Expanse at the minute, where me and Elton are currently going through The Expanse, which, if you're not watching it, one, for shame, and two, go and watch it. It's on Amazon because it's pretty much the best science fiction show on TV. Fight me. And yes, you can find that over at rogue2media.com and all good podcast catching places. And when I can remember to do it, I also do The Great Derelict, which used to be called Space.Jewy, but now I just talk about whatever I kind of fancy. And I've been a bit lackluster the last month, but I do have another episode planned. And you'll be able to find out where Anne-Marie's been hiding when she's not been doing this.
Oh, right. No doubt doing far more infinitely exciting things than this. Anyway.
You wouldn't agree, but the others might.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you, sir.
No, you're welcome.
Yes, the Expanse, when it's firing on full cylinders, is a jolly good series.
It's always firing on all cylinders.
We have a disagreement over that, I think. But anyway,
no, we don't have a disagreement. You're wrong. But we still love you.
Particularly the last series we watched, which was series 3, was it?
Yes, that was the last one.
Yes, with the slow motion thingy. There was a moment in that where I haven't laughed so loudly in a long while.
Yes. That. In fact, you laughed so loudly, you felt the need to message me.
Yes. Yes, that's worth the admission fee alone. Okay. Anyway, that's enough of The Expanse. We've got more on Next Generation to talk about, but thankfully not for another month's time. Because we need time to recover and drink
I should
beer.
Warn people, the whiplash between going from The Expanse to season 1 of Next Generation might be what you get in season 3 of The Expanse.
Yeah. But on the other hand, if you want more of the same, then over on bOrgCast Galactica. the next episode to go, we'll be covering the end of season 1, which are actually some jolly good episodes, so it's worth catching those. And then we hit Galactica 1980.
Which, by comparison, will make Next Generation season 1 seem like a fucking Shaft.
It'll seem very, very competent, if nothing else, yes. Anyways. So that's a jolly good wheeze, and that you can find that on Libsyn as well as iTunes. Jolly good. Well, we'll catch you next time. Cheery bye.
Ta-ra.
Music at the beginning of this podcast was written and performed by Adam Buxton and is used with his kind permission. All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
Find our website at bOrgCast.libsyn.com.
And we have a YouTube channel as well.
You can find the bOrgCast playouts on Spotify for your listening pleasure.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send emails or MP3s to bOrgCast@gmail.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCast Ammo. #bOrgCast. We're the
a spaceship, we're so good at being bad. We'll destroy your little planet if you ever get us mad. We're mothers of the galaxy, you better scatter when you see.
Shut it down!
Shut up, Wesley.